Namaste and welcome to this special live stream of the Bharat Varta podcast. We apologize for the delay. I'm your host for the day, Srivatsa Subarna. Today joining me is one of the foremost mathematicians from India and professor at IIT Kanpur, Professor Manindra Agarwal. Professor Agarwal has had a stellar career as an academic and a researcher, and has won many prestigious awards, including the Godel Prize, the Clay Research Award, the Fulkerson Prize, the Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Prize for Science and Technology, and also the Padma Shri in 2013, among many other awards. Sir, welcome to Bharat Varta. It's a privilege to host you. Pleasure to join.
Delighted to be here.
Thank you so much, sir. Sir, actually, before we start off with questions on Sutra, I just wanted to ask you, you know, the whole motivation behind the AKS primality test, right, for which you won many awards. Can you talk about, you know, how this idea came to you and how long it took for you to come up with the final algorithm and, you know, some of the challenges you faced in coming up with this?
Well, okay, that's a little... And a long time ago, but if I recall correctly, we looked at this paper in 1998, which used randomness in a very unique way. And we thought to apply the same ideas on some other problem. They had applied it on a specific problem. And we just came up with primality testing as one very interesting problem where we can potentially apply this. And in about a year, we did succeed in finding a similar unique random algorithm for primality testing also. And then since then, I thought that perhaps using the same ideas, one can eliminate randomness altogether. Right. And that I worked alone for some time and for 2 years. And then I was joined by these two students, Neeraj Kayal and Nitin Saxena. So they worked with me for another year. So finally in 2002, we solved it. So it took basically from beginning to end 4 years.
Fantastic. So that's a great way to start. So sir, you know, the National COVID-19 Modeling Committee was formed in 2020. So initially, what were some of the terms of reference? You know, it's a very bureaucratic term, but that's how I guess the government operates.
Yeah.
And what were some of the outcomes that you were looking to achieve with that?
So terms of reference were very simple, actually, to reach out to all modeling groups in the country and ask them to submit their model for COVID-19 pandemic, evaluate them and synthesize some of them, basically come up with a synthesized or a collection of models, which can then be used as the predictive mechanism for the COVID pandemic in the country. And that was called as a supermodel. That basically our aim, target given to us was to synthesize a supermodel. So the committee did reach out to about 35 plus groups and received many submissions and evaluated them. And so that exercise started in June and went until August. Now, by July, we had identified three models out of the submission, which we felt can be put together. One was a top-down model, that is, it started with it's a general model which could be applied to any population. The second was bottom-up, so it actually modeled individuals as separate entities, and then how they interact and so on and so forth. Of course, so, that required this very significant computational resources, because if you have like in a city, already big city, several crore people, and you have to model that many agents. So we tried to synthesize it, but what we found was that the bottom-up model could not scale up beyond a city. And even for a city, it required a very significant time to actually model a city, because you have to, every city has its own peculiarities and so on and so forth. The business district is somewhere, you know, shopping district is somewhere else, and then you have to see where are the residential parts and how was the movement of people from one to another, and so on. And the other one was not giving good predictions. So that's where we were left with a bit of a situation where we found ourselves as not being able to recommend anything to the government. That potential embarrassment kind of forced some of us to improve upon that one of that top-down model that we had shortlisted. That was not giving very good results, but we managed to improve that so that we could start predicting in a reasonable way. And sure. That's what eventually happened. Yeah.
So, before we get on to, the model and the improvements, historically, what have been some of the approaches to modeling a pandemic?
Well, historically, this whole story of modeling started in 1927 when Kermit and McKendrick looked at the data for Spanish flu, and they gave this model called SIR model, which can predict the which could predict at the time the trajectory followed by the Spanish flu. And what this model simply does is it divides the entire population into three groups. Susceptible are those who are not yet infected, but are susceptible to get infected anytime. Infected are those who are currently infected. And removed are those who were infected in the past, but are no longer infected. And the movement is, of course, from susceptible group to infected group and infected group to removed group. Removed group also includes those who die, but because the characteristic remains that they are no longer infected. And they gave us a couple of differential equations which model the movement, that in one day, how many will move from susceptible to infected and from infected to removed. And based on that, those differential equations, which are governed by two parameters called beta and gamma. Beta is the contact rate, gamma is the removal rate. And once you can get a good value of these two parameters, then you can run similar dose differential equations and extract the pandemic projection.
Right. So, sir, how has the model evolved, the models that you have worked on, evolved from, so what's the difference between SIR and Sutra? So how has that evolution been?
Yeah. So basically, this was the SIR at the beginning, then many other models have been given building on it. At the end of the day, they are all SIR models.
Okay.
What they do is they refine this a little further. For example, and typically the refinements occur on the eye. The infected group, because what SAIR does is it splits the infected group into two parts, asymptomatically infected and symptomatically infected. Asymptomatically infected are those who exhibit no symptoms, so they are not aware that they are infected. And then symptomatically infected are those who have symptoms, they possibly get tested they move to the symptomatically infected. So the then transition is like four groups now. S susceptible, A is asymptomatically infected, I is symptomatically infected, and R is removed. Movement is again from S to A, and then A to I, and I to R. Now it is possible, for example, in case of COVID, not everybody in A moves to R.
Right.
Because a lot of people remain asymptomatic and they recover. So there is a movement also directly from A to R.
Yeah.
So you set up equations for these and then you have the SAIR. Now, until that time, until frankly our model, all of the models that have been given have the following challenge. That how do you estimate? So because this size of SIR group is a time-varying entity. right? S monotonically decreases with time. I can increase or decrease, and R monotonically increases with time. So at any point in time, what can you say about the size of S or I or R? Well, the data that you get is only the ones who reach some hospital and doctor who records it and reports it.
Yes.
Now that number is a lower bound on the actual number. So typically this would be I. No, somebody in S is hardly going to report. R is also not going to report. It's those in I who have some problem that they are going to report. And so what you get from the records is an underestimate of I. And typically,
but, sir, if I could just ask you, wouldn't there be an underestimate of S as well if there are asymptomatic people who can infect others?
Mm-hmm.
There would be some amount of underestimation with S and likewise with R as well, right?
Well, S or R, you can't, S you can't estimate. Correct. At all. Forget it. And there is no way you can record. But of course, you can indirectly estimate S. If you can estimate I and you can estimate R, then you subtract this two from population, you get S.
Yeah.
But for both I, so if you get your estimate of I correct, then you can estimate R also, because eventually everybody in I moves to S, R. So with a time lag, you can estimate R also. But the key thing is, how do you estimate I? And the recorded data will always be an underestimate, and a significant underestimate. And even more so for COVID, because a very large number of guys are asymptomatic. So they don't report, of course. And then what you see is actually something very small. So that is a challenge. So because you can't estimate sizes of these categories, there is no way to estimate the parameter values from data. So what then you need is this epidemiologist who, what they do is, they look at the virus property, they look at the mobility of the region under consideration, how many people, what is the population density, how many people are moving around, who are they meeting. And then based on all that analysis, they estimate this beta and gamma parameter values. And that's what they continued doing for COVID also. Right. But COVID, with this additional requirement that very large number of them are not reported. So you have, like, SAIR has another parameter, which is ratio of, ratio of A and I. So you have to make a guess of that number also. Mm-hmm. And you see a lot of epidemiologists say it's actually 10x, some say 15x, that actual number of cases. So they make some educated guesses about this. So that's where things were. And there was another challenge with COVID, but also with earlier pandemics, that when a pandemic starts, it is not spread over the entire population. It's probably limited to certain regions. So at that time, assuming you can measure I and R, to get S, you don't subtract I and R from the overall population, because there are regions where the pandemic has not even reached. So those guys are not susceptible. They're not in the picture at all. So what you need also is an estimate of what is that population over which the pandemic is currently active.
Right.
Only then you can estimate these three quantities in a sensible way. So you need a time, there's another time varying quantity, the population over which a pandemic is active. So you need an estimate of that also. Nobody till date did that estimate. None. They all assume that overnight pandemic spreads over the entire population, which was okay earlier because there were no controls applied. So generally pandemic did spread very fast. But with COVID, a lot of effort has been made to control its spread. And so Certainly, it did not spread very fast over the entire population. So one needs actually a good estimate of the effective population, which varies with time.
Right.
So all these complications were there, and that's why one would see, frankly, there isn't any model which could predict COVID trajectory with reasonable accuracy over a long period. There are like 10, 15 days projections were there, but long-term predictions were really missing.
Right. So, sir, for our viewers, can you give like an overview of the Sutra model? If you
yeah,
want
sure.
to share your screen, I have.
Sure. I can share. Can I share my screen then?
Yeah. Absolutely.
So I'll just skip over this. Let me just the various equations that I have just written earlier. That's fine. Just want to introduce some variables which I will be using. You know, this all these category groups S, I, R. To denote their sizes, one uses variables, and the variable names are just after the category. Susceptible sizes S of T, asymptomatic sizes A of T, and symptomatic infected is I of T. There are three categories of populations, so their sizes, which is a time-varying quantity, is denoted by three variables. S of T denotes the size of susceptible category. I of T denotes the size of infected category. And R of T denotes the size of removed category. But these sizes are, for convenience, denoted in terms of fractions. So you just take the underlying population and divide all of these numbers by that population so as to have this invariant that S plus I plus R is always 1. And then one starts setting up these differential equations, which I will not go in details of. In fact, instead of that, let me go to the heart of the Sutra model. There is another quantity or variable that I'm going to use is N of T. N of T is at time T, how many new infections have been created.
Right.
So typically T is will move in days. So every time instant will be a new day. So N of T can be thought of at day number T, how many new infections came up. So the point that I was making about population is important, for example, to the following reason, that certainly N of T is, if all the new cases were reported, then we'll know N of T, how many new cases in a day has come up. But if N of T is actually the fraction, and so the fractional value of this we cannot compute until we know the size of underlying population, which is also a time-varying quantity. So first thing is to model this time-varying population. It's a pretty simple way to model. Make it a time-dependent quantity. P of T is the population over which the pandemic is active at time T. And just define a new parameter, rho, to be P divided by P naught. P naught is the population, total population of the region. So it's clear that rho is a number between 0 and 1. It's also clear that when the pandemic starts, rho will be very close to 0. And as the pandemic spreads, it will eventually come close to 1. So rho will be typically a monotonically increasing value with time and varying from 0 to 1. This is a new parameter that we introduced to model this change of population size, and we call it the reach of the pandemic. So the effective population over which pandemic is present at any time is rho times P naught. Okay. Once we have that, yes. Okay. So just showing how that very simple way in which we have modeled the varying population over which pandemic is active. So just define, let P of T be that time-dependent population, and define a new parameter rho to be ratio of P with the total population of the region, thereby making rho between, take value between 0 and 1, and it takes a value close to 0 when the pandemic begins and eventually ends up something close to 1. And we call it the reach of the pandemic. That's quite easy. Another a very positive or interesting thing about COVID pandemic is for the first time, very extensive data is available. I literally have district-wise time series of daily new infections, recoveries, deaths. Of course, these are just only reported data, which is, a lot of arguments have been made that a lot of there is under-reporting in it, there is testing limitations are there. So all that combined, what it certainly does is that what is reported is nowhere close to what the actual number is. So if given this, and the fact that extensive data is available, so one would like to use it in some way, can one use this to estimate parameter values? And if the data was available, I think there is a very, if the real data was available, there is a good way of estimating parameter value. Let me just quickly go back to SIR. Here is it. Okay. So if, like I said, N of T is the fraction of new infections coming in at time T for SIR model, then we have the new infection at time T is proportional to size of susceptible and infected fraction. That reason being that new infections are created by an interaction between an infected person and a susceptible person. Mm-hmm. And the number of subconnections are proportional to S times I. Yeah. So that's proportional to, so therefore N is proportional to SI, so let's make it beta times SI. And S is, since we know S plus I plus R is 1, so we can just rewrite this as I is equal to 1 over beta times N plus I plus R times I. So this gives a linear relationship in these three quantities, I, N, and I plus R times I. And in case we could somehow measure these three quantities over even for a few time periods, then we can really get the beta value out of this. We don't have to use other mechanisms to estimate beta parameter value. We can just pick it up from data. The problem is, of course, even in general pandemic, such data is not available. And all the more so in COVID-19, yeah, because the reported data is really, really far off from the actual data. So the question is that data of some value? And that's a question that we asked. So let's first define some quantities which are related to the reported data as opposed to actual data. So N sub T is the fraction of daily reported infections. T of T is a fraction of reported active infections. And R of T is fraction of total removed fraction of population, but that is reported, among the reported cases, not otherwise. So instead of N of T, what we see is N of T. Similarly, instead of I, what we see is T. And instead of R, what we see is R sub T. So these are the some scaled down quantities that we get to see. And actually, the numbers that are reported is not these. These are actual fractions. So numbers reported are that these fractions multiplied with the population, which is rho p naught, we just argued. So this t hat, r t hat, and n t hat are the three quantities we get to see every day.
Right.
And these are the three quantities that are measured. So with the question that can pose is that is there a relationship between these three quantities? And going back to the SIR analysis that we did, there is a relationship between, there were three quantities which had a linear relationship, I, N, and I plus R times I. These three were linearly related. And this is the hypothesis that we made, that that reported versions of those three quantities are also linearly related. T hat is equal to some B times NT hat plus some E times T plus RT hat times T hat. Now this constant B and E, there that was B was 1 over beta and E was 1 for SIR case. But here we are saying there could be something else. Make it more general, basically. Yeah. The good thing about this hypothesis is that it can be verified. Well, okay, this is just a recollection of the SIR model version.
Yeah.
Why can it be verified? Well, simple, because these three quantities are reported every day. Exactly. So we can compute them and choose just see if there is. In fact, you can, those who have more geometrically inclined can view this as a every day you get a three-dimensional point, T hat, NT hat, and T hat plus RT hat times T hat. And so in three-dimensional space, you get the sequence of points. And this relation hypothesis is saying that those points lie on a plane. And you can check if they are lying on a plane or not. So, represent that three-dimensional hypothesis on two dimensions, what I'm going to do is I'm going to plot T hat minus B times NT hat against T hat plus RT hat times T hat with an appropriately chosen value of B. And we see if these points now with this, these points now it becomes a two-dimensional quantity and it should lie on a line passing through the origin with the slope being E. So since we have all the data, so let's start looking at that, starting with India data, March 23 to April 23. These are the points. And this is the line through the origin, this light orange one.
Yeah.
With slope of this is 39,164. And the value of B we have chosen is 3.86. Now, those who are familiar with linear regression, the R square value of this fit is 0.998.
That's pretty high. Right?
So what it's showing is it's actually almost perfectly fits. It's really this point. Of course, there will be some error in reporting. Yes. So you perfectly lying straight on a line, you can't expect. But the point is that with R square value so close to 1, what it essentially is saying is that y coordinate is perfectly explained by the x coordinate. Okay, let's move on. April 29 to June 20. E has come down dramatically to 917. B has actually gone up to 6.38 and R square has become 0.999. July 21 to August 21st. E comes down further. R square still is very high. B has changed slightly. September 21st to November 1st, again, B has changed slightly. E is now down to 82. R square remains as high as ever. November 12th to December 31st, E is now more or less stabilized. B has come down now. R square is high. January 22 to January 31st, March 22 to March 28th, and finally, April 24th to May 17th. E is now down to 38.6. B is down to 3.52. R square remains as high as ever. You can see all these points lined up on the line. So once you look the entire India timeline, and if you see, if you notice, there are some gaps of days. You see March 28th, then it starts at April 24th.
Right.
So what I'm not shown is that some day, intermediate days, they don't, obviously the reason I'm not shown is because they don't lie on the line. So if you count the entire timeline, turns out that about 62% of days do lie on this, or rather they said do satisfy that linear relationship with varying value of BNE. And how many times this varies, values vary? 9 times.
Right.
There are this, so we call them phases. For each value of BNE, when the linear relation is satisfied, we say that's one phase. And as the value pair of values changes, we say the phase has changed.
Right.
So this is a very strange phenomenon. Firstly, that what is clear is that this data has some intrinsic structure. Otherwise, there is no way such a large number of points will satisfy such a this linear relationship in a strong way. Because remember, if this was the actual data, then it would satisfy the linear relationship. That we have seen. But it's not the actual data, and still it's satisfying the linear relationship. But of course, with a different constant. So that's also another thing which I'll come to. But one may ask, is it something unique to India? No. Here is what our analysis showed. We have analyzed 26 countries so far, all states and UTs of India. And actually, this 200 is old number. By now, 300 plus districts of India. Every single one of them shows this property. Every single one of them. So this is a universal property. It is not region or time limited. So the question is, why is this universal? What kind of property is this? And just to show another example, here is Japan data. And it's very similar to India data. Very high R-square value. The value of E starts high and then keeps coming down. And there are these very excellent fits, very, again, just like India.
Right.
So for Japan, the equation holds for about 60, roughly the same percentage of days as India, with 10 different phases. Because in Japan, the pandemic started before India, so it has one more phase. Another interesting observation is for both Japan and India, the value of E starts very high.
Right.
And then almost monotonically drops down rapidly, and then sort of becomes, the drop becomes slow and then tends to stabilize. Not fully stabilize, but kind of the drop reduces in slope. So this raises the following questions. That firstly, why does this linear relationship hold for, let's say, almost 2/3 of days? That's question number one. And it's a universal property. Mm-hmm. Second, it's also a universal property that the equation does not hold for several days. Why is that? And third, what is this E? I mean, this E is some very wildly varying quantity. Is there any sensible explanation? Because B is still in a range. Mm-hmm. You could see that B was varying between, let's say, 3 and 7. But V, E is varying very, very widely. So what really is happening here? Now, these are the questions that led to the Sutra model. And here is the brief description of it. We divide the entire population into 4 groups, susceptible. Then again, infected is split into 2. Undetected infections and tested positive infection. Undetected, not all of them move to tested positive group. Some of them directly go to remote, and some of them test positive and come here, and then they eventually go to remote. What we can measure perfectly is this tested positive. By very definition, when you test positive, you know the person is infected, and that gets reported. And that the first letters of these 4 categories, S, U, T, R, is what is the sutra name coming from.
Recording in progress.
Yeah.
Okay. So we actually define, split the population into five groups, and I'll explain why instead of four. This removed category, I further refine it in R sub U and R sub T. R sub U are those basically who undetected who directly get removed, and R sub T are tested positive who get removed. The reason is that we can measure R sub T also. We can measure T and we can measure R sub T. Again, because that's a daily removal data gives me R sub T value. So we can measure these two numbers, at least T hat and R sub T hat, not the fraction, but the absolute number. And we have this usual invariant, the sum of these five is one, and there is a certain dynamics. I will not spend too much time here. There is a certain novelty we introduced here, and that's why I would say the key novelty in terms of the dynamics, which is how many in one day move from U to T? That is, how many get tested positive in one day? So we can assume without any problem that anybody who gets infected is initially undetected, obviously. And at some point, the person may get tested and move to the T category.
Sir, if I could just interrupt you.
Yeah.
The reinfections, how are they factored in?
Reinfections are not factored in yet. We can factor that in, but for now, we are not incorporating that. There is one issue that there is very sketchy data about reinfection that is available.
Absolutely. It's almost anecdotal that I...
Yeah, just everything is anecdotal. So you can't really know, begin to see where is one going.
Yeah.
Okay. Typically, like SAIR model, what it does is in from movement from A to I in one day, it makes it proportional to the size of A. And we can do that here also, that we make the number of people who move from U to T in one day, make it proportional to size of U. It makes a sense that the larger undetected population is, more testing may be done or test may result more positive cases.
Right.
And that's what N sub T. N sub T is new infections every day, which are tested positive. That's delta. But it's not a very good choice. The reason is the contact tracing that is done. The way contact tracing is done is a person gets infected, develops symptoms, gets tested positive. The moment the person is tested positive, all the persons who came into contact with this person in past few days are tested. Some of them may turn positive. And then further levels of contact tracing may be done, but this much is certainly done. And this means that firstly, the person who develops symptoms and tests positive, generally agreed that within 5 days or so, a person develops symptoms after getting infected. And secondly, those who test positive through contact tracing all got infected after this person was infected, because it's this person who infected others. So what that means is, and for every tested positive through symptomatic test, a few, more than one, will probably test positive through contact tracing.
Right.
So what this does is it biases the tested positive cases towards more recent infections.
Yeah.
So what ideally we want is to define newly tested positive cases to be a fraction of recently infected cases. The question is, how do we estimate the size of recently infected cases? Well, we have beta SU is the most recently infected cases. It is the ones who just got, infected yesterday or just in last day. And assuming, and it's a reasonable assumption, that the number of new cases doesn't vary dramatically in a window of a few days. So we can take some constant times beta SU as a good estimate of the recently infected number. And a fraction of that is tested positive. So delta fraction of that and I set delta k to be epsilon, and that's a new parameter. So n of t is therefore epsilon beta s. So that's a better capture of the movement from u to t, and it has the additional advantage. Generally, what happens is if you get gained somewhere, then you lose somewhere else. Here we gain in analysis also. The analysis becomes extremely nice. And I'll again not get into there. And conclusion of the analysis is the following. That very soon, so t, basically, that is size of t, is epsilon hat times size of u. Epsilon hat is just epsilon over 1 minus epsilon.
Yeah.
Plus a times e to the minus gamma t. And this is a decaying exponential.
Yes.
So very soon, this becomes negligible. And we can assume that u is equal to t by epsilon hat. Similarly, we can derive that ru is rt by epsilon hat plus some constant. And this gives us a handle on size of u. I know size of t. And if I can estimate epsilon, then I know what u is. Similarly, I know can compute what ru is. If I can compute epsilon and c. And further, the new test, epsilon beta su, the newly tested positive or epsilon beta su, as I just observed. And now I use this convergence to replace u by t, t over epsilon hat. And for s, I substitute 1 minus u minus t minus ru minus rt. And just simplify this. I get nt is equal to this. Clearing the denominator with that population, so everything moving to t hat, I get t hat is equal to this quantity times nt hat plus this quantity times t hat plus rt hat times t hat. And this quantity I set to be b. This quantity I set to be e. So I leave p naught underlying population there. So it is this. And this is the fundamental sutra of the model. This is exactly the linear relationship that was hypothesized.
Right.
And so, this also tells to what those B and E, what is the meaning of B and E? It is this.
Right.
Yeah.
So, sir, just a follow-up question related to that. What were, you mentioned like the data, right? How good the data is, the availability of data and so on. What were some of the other challenges you faced in building this model?
Well, I think once you have this, then, you know, the life becomes very easy because, I should mention one challenge. Yes. So we have now 6 parameters.
Right.
Beta, gamma, eta was earlier from SIR. I have epsilon, C and rho also. Right. So the question is, how do you estimate now 6 parameters? We had trouble estimating even 3 parameters of SIR model. Well, the good thing is, look at that fundamental equation. We have B and E as some combination of these parameters. And we have this, these three quantities are, I have the time series reported right. Values.
Exactly.
So one can simply, just by doing a linear regression, compute the value of B and E from data. Not from nowhere else, just from data. So we can get it. Of course, the B and E keep changing, so that's a phase change. So you have to, every phase, you have to recompute the value. Just very quickly, I'll finish it off. Changes are also, because I want to answer those three questions that I raised in the beginning.
Right.
So phase changes are definitely going to happen.
So the question I had was, lockdown and some behavioral changes, right? Mm-hmm. Once the epidemic or pandemic kind of spreads, people maybe mask more. What's the impact, what's the impact of that on the model?
Well, this is the slide that explains it. When you put a lockdown or people start wearing masks, isolating themselves, that reduces the contact rate. Namely the parameter beta. Beta measures how fast is pandemic spreading. You remember that is beta was the constant to the new infections were beta SU.
Yeah.
So SU, number of connections remain the same. It is just that what beta measures, how many of them actually result in new infections. So if there is a lockdown, masking, it will bring down beta. Conversely, if there is a lot of crowding and there are new mutants which are more infectious, it will increase beta. Epsilon parameter will change if there is testing. It really depends on testing strategy adopted. And finally, spread of infection to new areas will continuously increase rho.
Right.
Okay. So therefore, the parameter values don't stay stationary over the entire timeline. And their change in their values actually tells us something very interesting. That it tells us, beta tells us how fast is the pandemic spreading. Rho tells us what are the new areas it is going to. And epsilon, of course, tells us, connects with the reported and the actual cases. It connects the two.
Right. And also, could you explain, you know, when more and more people get vaccinated, mm-hmm. how does that get factored in?
We have not factored that in the model yet. And so far, there was no need to, because the percentage of vaccinated people is extremely small. But going forward, that fraction is going to increase. So we will bring that into the model. Our target is next month, we will bring into the model vaccination as well as the loss of immunity.
So, sir, another question is, you spoke about the spread, right? So when it spreads to a new area, mm-hmm. and the virus spreads to a new area, there are few things that happen, right? Initially, mm-hmm. people may be a bit lax, so the spread might be a bit higher. Then there could be, so how is that, you know, your increase of that population, that susceptible population, how are you kind of factoring that in as well?
That's through rho. The parameter rho, as it spreads into newer areas, the parameter rho increases. That's a large, that basically is telling us the larger fraction of population is now, has now become amenable for infection. So it's under the coverage of the pandemic. Not just new areas. Actually, another interesting thing is that a lot of people isolated themselves quite well. So they were also outside the region. Even if, they, let's say, this pandemic was present in a city, within the city, many people had isolated themselves. Okay. So not the entire population of the city was under the coverage of the pandemic. And when they moved out of their isolation, then they came under the coverage. So the rho also increased there.
Right. So, sir, one more question was related to, you know, this thing that kind of comes up a lot in social media, which is underreporting and undercounting.
Yep.
According to your estimates, what is, you know, the extent and like, does that also affect the model in some way?
Okay, there are two questions here. Firstly, it doesn't affect the model. Now, with, of course, it can potentially affect it if the undercounting factor is changing very rapidly. Like every second day, there's a new factor. But in reality, it doesn't. And if that was the case, then that linear relationship that I described in data will break down completely. But it doesn't happen. As I observed, that it doesn't happen. It doesn't break down. And so what we can conclude from that is, whatever is the underreporting is somewhat consistent,
right,
at least across if one phase. And we can, through our model, estimate its value.
Right. So, sir, I think I've covered almost all the questions that mm-hmm. I've also got on YouTube and the questions that I had. But I had one last question for you, which is, you know, more outside Sutra, which is, what are some of the, you know, other research areas you're working on in terms of, you know, how technology can be used for in real life? So if you could just talk a little bit about that, it would be great.
Well, okay, so that's some of the projects that I'm working on are one I already mentioned is this national blockchain project, where a very generic blockchain framework has been developed, which can be deployed for hosting of government services of all kinds. The special part or unique part of that is that you don't These are going to be permission blockchain, so only a small few nodes will be authorized to generate and verify all the transactions. And but it provides a, like for example, land records, it can provide a immutable storage of data. There have been many cases, even in digitized world, that land records were changed. Unauthorized in an unauthorized way. That's not possible with blockchain. Similarly, many other kind of services that the government has for citizens can be hosted on a blockchain to increase the trust and transparency. There are, a few other projects. One was again related to COVID is that I'm been involved with is. To estimate and audit the oxygen supply required by various hospitals or districts. So there is some work that is happening there. So some of these projects I've been involved with over years, which are like perhaps slightly away from my core interest of just doing mathematics, which doesn't really have much value.
That's actually not true. I mean, almost all of cryptography is pretty much based on prime numbers, right? So there's definitely a lot of practical value with mathematics. So, sir, this has been a really fascinating discussion. I mean, I think our understanding of the model and some of the challenges you faced and some of the questions that people normally have, all of them have been addressed. So thanks a lot for your time. Thank you for being with us. So till our next episode, do stay with us, keep watching Bharat Varta, and Jai Hind.
Thank you.
Thank you for tuning in to this episode of the Bharat Varta podcast. If you want to see more content like this, then don't forget to subscribe to our channel. We started Bharat Varta to facilitate long-form discussions on politics, policy, and culture. We don't necessarily endorse anything that was said in this episode. If you wish to offer us feedback, do reach out to us on social media. We are at Bharat Varta on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. You could also get in touch with us on our website, www.bharatvarta.in. The links are in the description below. Until next time, stay safe, take care, and Jai Hind.